My name is Jonathan Edwards. I'm the chair of the Whately Board of Selectmen. And we're thrilled to host this informational gathering tonight where we'll listen to and watch a presentation by the South County EMS on all the great work they're doing right now and their vision for the future and anything else that Zach wants to talk about. As many of you know, this building and this facility is one of the options that SCEMS has for a permanent home. If anybody in the room is interested in touring the proposed facility where the EMS would be located after this is over, I'm sure that there are any number of people in this building that would be happy to show you the space. So I just wanted to point out, because this is easily the largest audience we've had in this room so far, there is a second emergency exit right here. So people are aware of that. And if anyone has having any health issues, there are any number of technicians here who can help you out. So that being said, I'm going to pass this over to Zach. By the way, SCEMS board, you want to raise your hands so that all the questions can be directed at you guys and not us? Okay. And Zach, it's all yours.
Thank you very much. As it was pointed out, this is probably the safest room in the three towns to be in right now with all the EMTs and paramedics. And you'll have to excuse us. One of our on-duty crew is present here tonight. So if we get interrupted by some radio chatter and they get up and leave, you'll just have to forgive them and understand what's going on. My name's Zach, Zachary Smith. I'm the director for South County EMS. I was with Deerfield EMS back in 2001. It was actually my first real bona fide EMT job, and I've stayed there ever since. It's just so great. I'm going to be talking about South County EMS now. We're just finishing up 2 years of operation. So I'm going to talk about what we've done, look at the statistics from this past year so we can kind of put things in perspective, talk about what we had before and where it compares now, and why there is a difference, what that difference is. I'm going to talk about operational stuff. That's my specialty. That's what I do day to day. If there's kind of those more grandiose, those larger questions, the Board of Oversight obviously is here as well. So between the two of us, we should be able to give you a decent question, or at least go from there. Sound good? Emergency exit, you have to get through me though. All right? Okay. Very good. Can everybody see this screen okay? More or less? All right.
Can we dim the lights a little bit?
Just the fronts?
Oh.
Observates, everybody.
Or not.
All right. All right.
Sorry.
So let's talk about what we are. I think a lot of people in the room already know what South County EMS is. There's a lot of EMTs in the room, a lot of our supporters. Since our inception, but what is South County EMS? So the technical explanation is we're the first regional municipal EMS third service in Massachusetts. What that means is we're the first of its kind in Massachusetts. We're a municipal department, so we're all employees of the town of Deerfield as a fiscal agent, but we're considered municipal but also regional because of our intermunicipal agreement and our Board of Oversight. And EMS third service means that we're not tied to a fire department. We're just our own thing. So it's very exciting. It's actually very exciting for everybody around the state. I've had the pleasure of going all over and talking about what we've done and telling them how they can do it themselves, because it's so brand new. Freetown Partnership, as we know, Deerfield, Sutherland, and Whately, and we offer 24/7 ALS, that's Advanced Life Support, ambulance, transporting the ambulance. It's a paramedic. And I'll get kind of into what makes a paramedic, but That's one of the major reasons why we regionalize and we combine our resources so we can provide that advanced life support. Of the three towns, Deerfield, Sutherland, Whately, it's actually 70 square miles and about 10,000 people that we cover as the primary ambulance. If any one of those 10,000 people picks up the phone and calls 911 and wants an ambulance, they get South County EMS. Beyond that, we go mutual aid. So when Greenfield or Amherst or Hatfield or Conway, they have more calls than they can handle, they call us. This is part of a normal thing all over the country. And our regular mutual aid accounts for an additional 91 square miles and 28,000 people. So that's kind of the scale of what South County EMS handles on a day-to-day basis. All right, so this print is a little bit small, but we'll talk about what we had and compare to what South County EMS is now. So previous, before South County EMS, before July 1st, 2014, all three towns had provided their own EMS service through one way or another. Deerfield had a similar, that third service, so it wasn't associated with a fire department, it was a municipal agency. And we had one person on shift, 16 hours a day, 7 days a week. If any of you are familiar with how an ambulance works, it takes two people to operate an ambulance, right? One person in the back, one person to drive. So with that one person on staff, that was kind of our stopgap. That if you call 911 between those hours, we'll send somebody right away, but we're still relying on our local EMTs to augment that crew. And overnight, we need to call for two EMTs. Sunderland and Whately, they were both associated with the fire department. So it was Sunderland Fire and Whately Fire, and Sunderland had a full-time firefighter EMT for 40 hours a week. Whately Fire, other than that, it was all the local EMTs that responded. And with Whately, it was 100% the local EMTs who responded. So when you call 911, you would get a regional dispatch center, and they'd say, what is your emergency? You'd say, I need an ambulance. And they'd say, okay, we'll send an ambulance. And what they would do was they would send out a phone, is what we call it. It's an acknowledgement over the radio. All the local EMTs have a pager just like this, and it says, we need an ambulance at 123 Main Street. And somebody would have to leave work, they'd have to leave dinner, they'd have to get up in the middle of the night, get in a personal vehicle, drive to the station, pick up an ambulance, and then drive to the house. All of those departments as well were either were not advanced life support departments. And what that means is that they provide basic level first aid. So it's a first aid course that's 100 hours long, it's EMT basic. But if you had any sort of medical condition that required that those advanced things, if you had chest pain, if you were having a stroke, if you were having a seizure that wouldn't stop, if you were having an asthma attack, if you were having a diabetic emergency, any one of those things would require a paramedic to also respond. And that paramedic came from either Northampton or Greenfield, if they were available. So you would call 911, you'd request an ambulance. That person would get up from their bed, go to their house, or sorry, from their house, go to the station, pick up the ambulance, drive them to your house, say, oh, you're having an asthma attack, I need paramedics. They would radio to our dispatcher, say, we need to start paramedics, can you please have them come? And then they would call down to Northampton and say, how fast can you get to Whately or Sunderland? And they'd say, ah, we don't have a truck available, try somebody else. And they're like, okay, Greenfield, how fast can you get to Sunderland? Okay, we'll leave right away, we got somebody at the hospital. So that's why our system was considered amongst the EMS to really be in need of a change, in need of an adjustment. What this meant was response time, so that from the time that you called 911, you said, I have a medical emergency, I need an ambulance. In Deerfield, the response time, fractal response time, was 17 minutes. Sunderland was 18 minutes, as was Whately. And then that paramedic service was greater than 20 minutes. And that was at the point at which it was identified that they were needed. So it could be 17 minutes plus 20 minutes before you saw a paramedic at your door. All right? So we're like, this has been working for years, but we need to make a change. So we had the Bruce Baxter study, we had this regionalization study, and they said you can absolutely do better. The makeup of your three towns is primed for this. So we combined all three towns, joined the intermunicipal agreement, and created South County EMS. So now, instead of waiting for paramedics to come from Northampton or Greenfield, we are paramedics. Our response time, our fractal response time, is 11 minutes. Our average response time is 7 minutes. So what that means is, before July 2014, over 20 minutes for a paramedic. Now under 10 minutes, and what a paramedic does is we bring the emergency room right to your side. And that's not hyperbole. I've got a stretcher with a lot of ALS out here out in the hallway we can look at some point. But literally, any life-saving intervention that you would get in an emergency room, we bring to you wherever you are. If that's in your bed, if that's in your car, if that's out in the woods, we bring it to you. And we do it on an average of 7 minutes. So that's why we're so excited. because we're doing great stuff. That's why I'm really excited standing here. Having come from 2001, Deerfoot EMS days, waiting for that paramedic having to sit on my hands to being able to provide that immediately. That's what South County EMS is. Sound good? If at any point you need me to clarify, you want to ask a question, I interject. I want this to be, I want to clear anything up, so feel free to ask. Yes, already.
Fract, would you explain what fractal is?
So fractal response times, this is, fractal response times represents, in this case, 90% of all calls. Their response time falls under that time. So our average response, this is a good example because we have both taken care of. These are data that I was able to pull from the previous report, so I don't have the average response time. For South County EMS, on average, you will get an ambulance in 7 minutes, 9 seconds. 90% of all calls will see an ambulance in 11 minutes or less. There's some weird statistic math there. Basically, that means is that when we get outliers, when we get to go to West Whately, if we go mutual aid up into Conway, if we have to go to Northern Sunderland, our response times are naturally going to be longer just because of the physical distance that we have to go. So it's kind of two different ways of looking at the same thing. And depending on what system you look at, they're going to present different numbers, whichever is more favorable to them. So I've given you both here. Did I even clarify what fractal response time is? Okay. 90% of all calls, you get there in 11 minutes or less. All right, so here's a year's worth of statistics. January to December 2015. I broke it down to three communities plus the mutual aid that I talked about, so Greenfield, Conway, Amherst. Average response times for those communities, and that's just reflective of distance. That's all that really is, because our out-of-shoot time, the time between the tow and our crew getting into the ambulance and physically leaving is going to be the same no matter what. So it's a little bit longer to Sunderland and Whately naturally because we have to travel further. We did 802 calls that involved some sort of patient in 2015. We do other things that don't involve patients, that don't generate a patient care report or a medical record. So things like fire standbys or missing person searches that wouldn't necessarily be captured in this. But we dealt with 802 patients, and we took 593 of them to the hospital. This is completely normal for an ambulance. About 70% of all patients that we deal with, we transport to the hospital. That other 30% either don't want to go for their own reasons, or we go and they're not injured, that somebody thought that they were injured, called on their behalf, and we arrive and they say, I'm fine. Or they had a medical condition that they've resolved themselves. It's not uncommon for somebody with a chronic condition like diabetes to have a low blood sugar incident. A loved one calls 911 and gives them sugar, and by the time we get there, their symptoms are relieved, they're feeling fine, and then we just leave. But we can't take you against your will, that's kidnapping, all right? And then we have to answer to Sergeant Bates back there. Thanks, Don. All right. The other breakdown here is ALS and BLS. What you should interpret this to mean that of these 308 people that from Deerfield that we took to the hospital, 230 of them required the skills or the expertise of a paramedic. Okay? So whatever the condition was, but be it an asthma attack, an ongoing seizure, 230 of them needed that. 78 of them did not require the skills of that paramedic. It doesn't mean that they weren't assessed by a paramedic, but whenever our ambulance leaves, it leaves with a paramedic on it. So they get assessed with that extra knowledge and extra expertise, but then it's decided they don't need those interventions. A bandage is fine, they've cut their hand or something like that, so they get transported at a BLS level. Our refusals, that's our term for somebody who refuses to go to the hospital. It's not a negative thing, they just don't want to go. And then that last column, other, those are incidental. So those might be, give me an example that's not sad. So that would be somebody who didn't need to be transported, didn't want to be transported, didn't refuse to be transported, of that nature. So that many times we responded, our services weren't needed, but it involved somebody. Okay?
Have you ever had an instance where you went on a call And the person may have not wanted to go, but because you had paramedics, you were able to convince that person that it had a serious problem?
So this is thank you. This sounds totally staged, but that's a great question. There are a lot of times where, as a paramedic, so let me expand on what a paramedic means. An EMT, I said, 100-hour course, 120-hour course. A paramedic goes to school for 3 years. They go to school, they do a whole classroom portion, and once they're done with that, then we release them out into hospitals. And they do time in the hospital, and they work along the doctors, the physicians, the nurses, the respiratory therapists, and they hone their skills, and then once they get their skills even more, then they go out into the field, and they have to ride an ambulance. And they do that for hundreds of hours. And then, only then, do we say, you're allowed to test now.
And then,
thank you, Gary, one of our mentors at South County EMS, they test. The state says, you've met the minimum requirements to wear the rocker, paramedic rocker. Now go back to your own service and spend another 100-something hours.
Many hours.
Many hours riding third. So with that expertise, paramedic means beside medicine. So working in conjunction with a doctor, that's kind of the idea. We work with standing orders. A doctor says, I trust you to do all these things. I'm not going to write an order every time. Here's your list of things I trust you to do. That paramedic can go into a scene and assess a patient nearly at that physician level. We have tools at our disposal to actually more or less diagnose a heart attack and say that you are having, according to my EKG right now, that I'm trained and authorized to interpret, you're having a heart attack. So there are times where we might be called to somebody who's just feeling weak or feeling lightheaded, but as a paramedic, we can do all these other assessments and all these other interventions and say, you know what, if you were in a doctor's office right now, you would be getting told the same thing that I'm able to do at your bedside. So we've actually found patients that otherwise were thought to be totally fine and were going to be left to their own devices, and when the paramedic arrived, said, no, you have a very serious medical condition, and ended up getting that person help that they needed.
Okay. Do you have statistics on missed calls?
Missed calls. So
either before South County EMS and now after, or is that in your presentation somewhere?
I can tell you for Deerfield.
20%.
20%. Prior to South County EMS, we missed 1 out of 5.
For Deerfield.
And now?
Now, I'll tell you, the numbers are, I don't know, but it's because they're so low. How many times mutual aid a month? Once? Twice?
Twice
a month, mutual aid, out of 800, 1,000 calls, give or take, yeah.
That's 25. You might add that that's usually because there's more than 2 calls going on at one time.
Yeah,
every time.
Yes. Unfortunately, here's the failure in our statistics with that. So we log and keep track of all of the calls, all the patients, the medical records that we handle. Anytime a call has to go to mutual aid, we don't have contact with that person, so we don't have a record of that person. Our regional dispatch center, I've spoken to them, requested that information. They're unable to give it to us, but anecdotally, we're talking about once or twice a month, which is outstanding as far as mutual aid. I mean, how often do we go to Greenfield mutual aid? Putting you on the spot, Gary. More than once or twice a month is my point.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll just say that. So we're on par, if not much better, than our fellow agencies.
I want to follow up on Tom's question a little bit. Tom talked about South County EMS getting to a location and the patient not having self-evaluated sufficiently and was told that, you know, they're in worse shape than. But one of the beauties that I think we have here is that we have trained EMSs, and before we had very skilled people who were not trained paramedics. So I guess, let me finish my question before, and you can correct my analysis.
Yes.
Has there ever been a time where people who got to the scene first, emergency response, non-paramedic level, misdiagnosed the issue, and you were, and when you assessed, you corrected their, just all the best intentions, but yeah, their skills didn't allow them to satisfactorily.
Yes, I'm I'm treading lightly here. There has been incidences in which non-EMS people, agencies, or people that were trained long ago and haven't maintained it, in our three communities have responded to a medical, made a judgment, or didn't make a judgment, but decided that that patient was ostensibly fine and was okay to be left alone. And when South County EMS showed up and our personnel showed up, they were like, no, 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 no. My training, my expertise, my familiarity with this patient tells me that something is amiss and something is awry. I'd be hesitant to say that what we had before weren't expertly trained people.
I'm not saying that.
And I know you weren't, and I just want to clarify that. I know you weren't.
They were great.
I think what the difference is, we now, with South County EMS, 24/7 have people that see the same patients all the time. They have that rapport. They're in the system all the time. So when they go to somebody who's not acting right, they can say, yeah, I saw this person last week, and last week they seemed to be more coherent, and this week they're less coherent. And that's something that a local EMS agency can provide that outsourcing to another agency just can't because of that lack of familiarity. Kind of one of the big things, this next slide here, and we do something in emergency medical services, they're called SAVE Awards. And basically it's a recognition of our EMTs, our paramedics, who have taken steps to save someone's life. And what we mean by that is they were in cardiac arrest, their heart was not beating, and then because of the efforts of our EMS staff, that person is now out and living a full life. That they walked out of the hospital, they're back with their loved ones. And in 2015, we had three saves with South County EMS. There we go, folks. Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Gary. We're giving an address out. I'll talk over that.
Is this staged?
This is not staged. When you do as many calls as we do, when they showed up tonight, they're going, we'll stay as long as we can because we knew that we were going to go up. So the SAVE Award, this means we had three incidences in the three towns last year that we believe wholeheartedly that person's life was saved because of the paramedics we had at South County. Because our response time is so short now, because we have those paramedics at their door, that person's life was saved. And in one instance, the school nurse was right there training with a defibrillator, and she really initiated and she started it. So she's included, her name isn't on here, but she was included in the SAVE Awards for 2015. So Kathy Belanger, Joshua Clemens, Eric Drumgoole, Tim Drumgoole, John Hanna, William Kimball, Aaliyah Kusma, Michael Mahar, Matt Marchand, Anthony Muzinski, myself, McClellan White, and David Zamoyski were all people that are recognized in 2015. He's actually left the room so I can embarrass him. There's something that these SAVE Awards don't do a good job of, and that's recognizing what we do for the community every day. And this was texted to me by a police officer, this image. That's Gary Ponce, paramedic. He just left on a call. And the police officer said, your EMTs are amazing, cooking food for an elderly woman with low blood sugar. I'll add, the call wasn't for low blood sugar. That was just kind of, this was a woman with a chronic condition who called 911 because she doesn't have any options in her life. She doesn't have the support staff in her life that a lot of us have the benefit of. So she called 911, and Gary had a rapport with her. He knows her, he's seen her before. So when he walked in, she's like, oh, hey, Gary, how you doing? And he talked to her, and she didn't need to go to the hospital. She really didn't. She just didn't have the support system that other people do. And Gary asked, do you have food? When are you going to eat next? And she's like, oh, there's something in the fridge. And he decided to make her dinner. And that's something that, I'm getting a little choked up. That's something that I try to promote at South County EMS, is that this is the thing that we can do, in that we can take that time. And Gary actually came to me afterwards, unaware this picture was taken. And he said, I hope it's okay, I was kind of on scene for a long time. He comes from a private ambulance company, I've worked there too, where they're very much, if you're not taking the patient to the hospital, we need you to clear, because we've got another call coming. And I told Gary, I want you to stay on scene. I want you to stay on scene, I want you to give this woman the care she needs. And if another EMS call comes in, we'll send another ambulance, we'll figure something out. We've got personnel around. So this is kind of the thing that the SAVE Awards don't capture, that I was lucky enough to get a picture for this. this time. So, okay, a little verklempt. So, all right, moving on. So how do we do it? We've talked a lot about this two ambulance, three ambulance thing. Let me just tell you how the department is built. How do we cover these calls? How do we provide these services? So we have that one ambulance staffed 24/7, the one that just left. That's a paramedic level truck. And that's full-time staff. It's actually 8 full-time people to cover that. If you do the math, there's actually an 8-hour block during the week that those full-time staff members don't cover. So for that block, and any time our staff members are at training, either mandatory or elective, which we encourage, or they're out sick, which we encourage to call out sick. We don't want you to get anybody else sick. Or they're on vacation, then we backfill it with our local EMTs, our per diem EMTs, or our part-time EMTs. Our second ambulance is staffed wholly by our local EMTs, and we do a system. This is when South County was sold and built, was this kind of ready reserve, this callback. So our local EMTs sign up for shifts on that ambulance, so when the first one leaves, those local EMTs go to the ambulance and they're available when they get a second call. And that third truck, which wasn't part of the original design, but we had it available. It was no sense in throwing it out and scrapping it. But that third truck now accomplishes is that it's the reserve for non-emergency events. So we're talking about elementary school. We went over to the Deerfoot Elementary School. When was that, AJ?
September.
They loved us so much, they called over to the Sunderland. I got an email from Sunderland Elementary, said, oh, we're having a job fair. Can you guys come over? So that's coming up. Our A3 will be over at the Sunderland Elementary School. Joshua Clemens will be there with the ambulance and allowing the kids and the parents to see that. Multiple calls, so multiple simultaneous calls or multiple patients from a single call. Long duration events, so we're talking about hazmat scenes or things like that. We can free up our primary ambulance and we can park A3 there for a long duration. And anytime ambulance one or ambulance two goes out of service, either an unexpected mechanical problem or a scheduled maintenance thing, A3 then steps in line, so we maintain that two ambulance fleet. I kind of already described day one. It's based on the South Deerfoot Fire Department, and that's because that's where Deerfoot EMS was based out of, and we have office space there for our staff. And it's also geographically most central to the majority of our calls. The majority of our calls are based on population density. So in order, we're talking about South Deerfield, West Sunderland, North Whately, Old Deerfield. So just kind of that's where the majority of our calls are, because that's where the majority of the people are. And that ambulance, A1, is able to cover approximately 750 calls a year, all right? If calls came in at regular intervals, it could cover 2,000 calls a year. But because it's all random, because people call 911 sometimes 5 stacked on top of each other, on average, we can cover about 750 calls a year. So that gap in calls between the number of calls we have, that's why we need the additional ambulance. A2, I talked about that. So it's staffed by our local EMTs who sign up. They get paid $8 an hour as a stipend just to sign up and be on call. And then when A1 goes out, they actually make their full hourly rate to sit and be available on A2. So they can have the same response time, rapid response time that A1 has. It's based out of the Sunderland Fire Department. It's also equipped at the paramedic level. So if we have a paramedic on duty or available, such as myself during the day, then that is also a paramedic level truck. We need this to cover the balance. So we have, in this case, 800 calls last year, so we needed it for those 50 calls we did, so about 6% of our calls. This truck could conceivably, you know, cover another 750 calls if we had the staffing for it, but that's why we need a second truck. And the big hurdle for this, which really came as no surprise, we were expecting this when we launched, was that those local EMTs to staff this truck just aren't available. We have a very, very solid, very intense group of local EMTs who are dedicated and staff this, but we need 8 full-time people to staff one truck. A handful of local EMTs isn't enough with their schooling and their jobs to cover this other one. And the reasons came as no surprise, because the reason we regionalized was because that local EMT base was getting smaller and smaller and smaller. Question.
I just want to clarify, to be paramedic level, you need paramedic supplies on a truck and paramedics?
Yes.
Is the supplies different for an EMT truck than a paramedic?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So that with that extra schooling that a paramedic receives that makes them be a paramedic, there's all the extra diagnostic equipment, all the extra drugs, all the extra toys, needles, and things that go along with it. So we both need both those components. So the truck needs to have paramedic equipment on it, which is above and beyond a basic level truck, and they need to have a paramedic to use it. So you need both those components. Thank you. This staffing, I talked about the difficulty in finding those local EMTs. We're actually starting something April 1st. We're kind of adjusting the way that we're trying to fill our A2 shifts. That the majority of our calls occur during the day, and we're thinking, you know what? If people aren't available during the day to respond to calls because they're at work, because they're at school, we're actually going to adjust. We're going to use that money more smartly, and we're going to have somebody be on shift. And I can get into the nuances of it, but we're really excited about it. Within a day or two of announcing the schedule change, nearly all of the shifts were signed up for April. So right out of the gate, huge response, and we're hoping that this will make a huge positive impact on how reliably we get personnel for ambulance too. And then ambulance three, there's our reserve truck. There it goes over the Summit Bridge.
Bye.
Not equipped at the paramedic level. There's a lot of things, like a lot of narcotics that have to be controlled, the security with it, a lot of drugs that expire, things like that. And just the price of that equipment can be prohibitive for a vehicle that is really just a reserve unit to do these standbys at the elementary school. We don't need paramedic gear if we're letting a kid put a stethoscope on a stuffed animal. So that is actually, it's at the intermediate level. So we can still intubate and provide some life-saving stuff like that, but it doesn't have all the paramedic gear on it. And the reason that we like it so much, like I said, it's available for those community events and large-scale emergencies. And if we need two ambulances to cover all of our calls, if one goes out of service, this vehicle, we put paramedic gear on it, and now we're still a two-ambulance fleet. And that's what that ambulance allows us to do. I'm sure there's going to be some questions later on about, are we two-ambulance service, a three-ambulance service? What's our replacement schedule? We can hatch that out.
Zach, just that third ambulance and the second, that also enhances your ability for revenue generation. Is that an accurate statement?
Absolutely. So every single time we transport a patient, so we are, it's no secret, right, that we bill for our service. You go to the doctor and your insurance company gets billed. You call for an ambulance and your insurance company gets billed, and you may or may not have a copay or things like that. So we do bill for our service. The other thing that we do is for certain standbys, when it's a private organization or even sometimes a public organization, they want an ambulance there. There is a fee associated. They can actually pay the same way that you could pay a police officer to work your high school prom and just kind of keep the peace. You can hire an ambulance to be on standby. So for all the Frontier football games, there's actually a small stipend out of their budget that goes to offset the cost for our EMTs to do that. So that third ambulance does allow a revenue stream as well. It doesn't sit there and suck money out of our accounts. All right, so let's talk about where we're housed right now. All right? So we lease space from three agencies, South Deerfield Fire, Summerlin Fire, and Whately Fire. That's because that's where the three ambulances were housed originally. It just made sense. We'll keep them in the same places that they are. The South Deerfield Fire District includes a personnel office, and my office as the director is actually the Deerfield Town Hall. That's where space was available. I needed a private office for obvious reasons for a department head, and that's where it was available at the Deerfield Town Hall, so that's where my office is. And all these stations were immediately available at inception. That we flipped the switch and we didn't have to move a single truck. They stayed right where they were. But we understood that this was kind of a temporary thing, that we don't take the police department and have them park a cruiser in three different garages and put the police chief in another. Like, okay, a fire station, a police department, an EMS agency, these all need to have a central location. So at our inception, even before 2014, the Board of Oversight was like, what are we doing? Where are we going? We don't fit in one of these places by themselves. What's our next step? So the Sutherland and Whately fire departments, our lease is approximately $11,000 and $3,200 a year, respectively, for a single ambulance bay. That's what we pay right now. They are fire departments, so they are secured. The doors are locked. But we don't have control over that. So we actually were unable to deploy paramedic gear on our second truck for quite some time because of security concerns and access concerns. Not a fault of the Sunderland station, but just us not being manned at that station staff there. We actually had to get some additional equipment in order to do that. The South Deerfield Fire Station, this is where A1 is based out of. $36,000 a year buys us a single ambulance bay and the personnel office. That personnel office is shared by 8 full-time employees. My 8 full-time employees, I've encouraged them to have duties above and beyond. With 800 calls a year, there is downtime. So we have somebody who's in charge of personnel. We have somebody who's like a kind of a morale stuff. We have somebody in charge of community outreach. We have somebody in charge of training. All those things are shared duties amongst our full-time staff. So those 8 people share a space. It's 12 feet by 17 feet. And I measured, and it's a coincidence, but this table here, that's 12 feet by 17 feet. So that's what this room is. This photo is taken from outside the door, and so the 12 by 17 doesn't include the desks or whatever. This also coincidentally goes as the rest, relaxation, and sleeping quarters for our personnel. So during the day, that staff shares these desks, and then at night, they inflate their air mattress or they take out their camping cot, and they sleep right there. That room gets very hot. 12 by 17, you got two EMTs, paramedics sleeping there. It's bad. We do have access to a kitchen, a small and large conference room that the South Deerfield Fire District controls. It's their building. So when those are available, we can eat lunch in front of the TV in one of the meeting rooms and things like that. So it's not solitary confinement, but this is our space. The other thing, too, is we have no control over access or security here either. And furthermore, the South Deerfield Fire Department has an electronic key fob thing to prevent outsiders from getting access. Makes perfect sense. They control that 100%. And so they limit the amount of access credentials I'm allowed to hand out to my staff. So we have a thing where if a call comes in, the doors unlock so staff can come in, but otherwise my staff isn't necessarily free to come and go to our staff office during the day or evening.
Just one point on that, Zach.
Yeah.
The rent at South Deerfield has been $18,000 a year the past 2 years. July 1, it goes to $36,000. They had reduced our rent. Initially, when we started up the service, there was some miscommunication about year 2, and there should have been some increase in there. The Prudential Committee at South Deerfield was good enough to hold the rent at that level, but informed us that year 3 it would go to the $36,000 a year.
So here's why this, if we haven't been able to figure this out on our own, this is our concerns with these 4 locations. So we just don't have the accommodations we need for the employees. For a full-time EMS fire department that has multiple personnel on a duty crew and responds 24/7 for extended duty cycles, we expect that they not only have office space for their administrative duties, but they also have living space. So you go to any fire department anywhere, and there'll be a rest area and an office area, and even bunk rooms to allow them to get some respite in between calls. Our physical separation of equipment is a huge hindrance. Our on-duty crew is based out of South Deerfield. In the morning, when they have to go and check and make sure the paramedic gear isn't stolen out of A2, which we don't think it will be, but it's part of their duties, they have to physically get in the truck and drive the truck over to the Sunderland station. And then they check the truck there, and then they have to physically drive over to the Whately station. That also means that restocking is a pain. We have all of our stock at South Deerfield. So if the Sunderland truck goes out, goes over to a place in Sunderland, we get a refusal, person's got a cut, they bandage it up, but now they need to restock that equipment, they have to drive it all the way over to South Deerfield for that bandage, and then drive all the way back to Sunderland. The ambulances A2 and A3 are not in the geographic center of our response area. So South Deerfield is, that's great, A1's out of there. But A2 and A3 are also needed to respond. So part of the reason why our response time actually isn't lower is because it also accounts for A2 and A3 responding from Sunderland and Whately back into Deerfield. So that adds response times. Security concerns, as I said, just these stations that we don't have control over and are unmanned. We don't know what's going on there. And operational inefficiencies. For all these reasons, it means that more hours of the day are taken out of just physically driving around or moving stuff around or things like that. So what are we looking for in a facility? What have we been looking for in a facility? And basically, this is just the opposite of everything I listed, right? So we need employee accommodations that can take care of the full crew 24/7. We need sufficient space for our ambulances, and that includes things like storage. They need to be climate controlled. We're required to keep our ambulances above freezing, and it's above like 53 degrees or something like that. Not only is it because of medications can go bad, but if you're having a medical emergency, you don't want to climb into an ambulance that's 20 degrees. And it accommodates vehicle cleaning, so we're talking like sometimes we have a very significant call. We'll come back to the station where we can restock and kind of take our time, so we need to be able to open our ambulances up. We need our personnel to be able to operate in that space and be able to decontaminate a truck, things like that. Needs to be centrally located, so we're talking about South Deerfield, North Whately. Let's be realistic here. So that's centrally located for the majority of our call volumes, or West Sunderland, I should say, right near the bridge. Operationally efficient, so it needs to make sense, right? I can't have my crews running all the way around a building in a hallway. They need to be close to vehicles and close to bathrooms and things like that. And lastly, but not leastly, it needs to be fiscally responsible. So we need to be able to answer as a board of oversight, as a department, that what we're paying for this makes sense. That ultimately it comes back out of all of our pockets. I'm a resident. Am I paying for something that's smart? I briefly touch on the budget here. I don't know if you really want to hammer it out, but this is what the service costs. $1 million annually. $1,077,299. This is FY17. That's what it costs to run, and that's everything. We're an enterprise fund. That means that we have to account for everything. That's retirement. That's health benefits. Things that in other municipal departments might be hidden in other parts of the budget, it's all on our sheet. So that's soup to nuts, personnel and equipment. We estimate for FY17 $410 in revenue from billing. I haven't heard this repeated recently, but I do want to make a point. An ambulance will never pay for itself. Okay? A private ambulance company that's in the business of transporting people to and from dialysis, or to and from rehab, or from nursing homes to hospitals, that can be a money-making, lucrative thing. A 911 emergency ambulance will never cover its own costs. So, $410,000 is what we anticipate to get from billing revenue. This might continue to grow as we get better and more efficient at what we're doing and can make more calls. And for FY17, we're also applying $60,000 out of retained earnings to this. So this is FY15 money that wasn't spent in our first year of operation. There was a lot of fuss about that, right? So money that wasn't spent for one reason or another, or because our revenue was bigger than we anticipated, is getting applied back into FY17. So once you subtract those amounts out of the budget, the amount left to be assessed to the towns is $607,225. And based on the formulas that have already been agreed on in the IMA and things like that, Deerfield pays 51.76%, Sunderland 31.48%, and Whately 16.76%, and that's your share. That's your share. This 51.76% is a complicated thing based on population density and ability to pay and all this stuff.
Equalized value,
thank you, Matt. Incidentally, based on our demographics in these three towns, this basically equals the amount of calls that we do to those respective towns as well. If I were to go back, you'd see we did like 52% of our calls to Deerfield. It lucks out that way based on our population density and the wealth and or lack thereof of all the residents in town collectively. But that's the share. That's just a comparison between FY16 and 17. The budget, you'll see, actually went up. That's to reflect the incidental administrative cost of the town of Deerfield and increased rent to South Deerfield Fire, but the offsets of the retained earnings and the increased revenue actually makes the total assessment less. We also have a, we're including on doing a, excuse me, also going to do a vehicle replacement in FY17, that's our plan. So there's a capital expenditure there, but that's also coming out of retained earnings, a chunk of which was our previous capital appropriations in here, and then some additional retained earnings. So we're covering the cost of that ambulance fully out of that. So that there's none of that is getting assessed to the town in FY17. And then there's your difference. So everybody's seeing a little bit of a decrease or a significant decrease depending on if you're an optimist or pessimist for FY17. So at least from my standpoint, operationally, what are my operational goals for this service? What am I looking forward to? What am I looking to achieve? Immediately, A2. A1, 24/7, staffed, able to cover 750 calls. Great, perfect, doing well. A2, we're relying very heavily on this local group of EMTs, and the demands on them are very, very high. So trying to figure out how we're going to work that, and we're hoping that this shift in scheduling in April is going to be a huge benefit to that. We're also, many of our EMT basics in the service are either currently in or have finished paramedic school very recently. So as paramedic Gary Pont said, there's still a lot of training that has to happen, but with those extra in-house paramedics now upgrading, it means that more consistently we're able to do some things with the schedule to cover more calls at the paramedic level. We need to fix our housing stuff. We have to do it. I don't know what the answer is. I mean, there's obviously the elephant in the room is Whately. I'll let the board speak to that. It meets the needs of us. Whatever the solution is, we need to find one. We can't stay where we are. South Deerfield, Whately, Sunderland have been incredible hosts, very generous, allowing us to stay as long as we need to. But the truth of the matter is we don't fit, and it doesn't work for us. So we have to find something else. And our aging fleet. So I talked about this in the budget one. Typically, an ambulance is considered viable for about 10 years, give or take, depending on the volume of the system, heavy or light, or any sort of unforeseen things, but basically 10 years. We inherited the vehicles from the previous service, it didn't make sense to buy anything new, but it means that our oldest truck is a model year 2001. It's the white one outside, if anybody wants to kick the tires on it. That truck is 17, nearing 18 years old. It's too old, and it sometimes breaks down when we're driving in places. Thankfully, not on the way to a call yet, but when it's serving back up to the other ambulances, it's a concern. And we're looking to get that vehicle out of our fleet, out of our hair. The expenses associated with maintenance of that vehicle is becoming ridiculous, so get that out of our hair. And then our other vehicles are an 07 and a 2010, which we love. They're great. I don't have any bad things to say about it. So that concludes my portion. Whew. And I only spoke for like 45 minutes. Thank you, everybody. I'm going to leave these names up here just temporarily at least because I think they deserve to be recognized as well. Some of them are in the room as well. But thank you very much. Any questions I can clarify? No? Yes?
Not necessarily anything you said, but last week's finance committee meeting
in Deerfield.
One of the members of the Board of Oversight said that 85% of the calls are between 10 and 6.
So let me clarify that. It's 65% of our calls are between 10 and 6. There was I've since apologized. There was a typo in one of my director's reports. Here's how it breaks down. When we were trying to figure out where A2 coverage is needed, as I said, the majority of our calls are during the day. And we've discovered that 81-something-something% of our calls are between 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. But to ask people to routinely sign up for 12-hour shifts just wasn't feasible. So we tried to figure out an 8-hour block that was workable and manageable. We talked to our EMTs, our per diem staff, who have to drop kids off at school, who come out of overnight shifts, And the consensus was that this 10 to 6 block not only was enticing to them, but also represented the majority of our calls, which comes in at 65% of all those times that we've needed A2. So 65% of our calls are between 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. So that 85% number was, as far as I can tell, a typo and my mistake.
So you said that 80% are between approximately 9 a.m. and 9 p.m.
Yep.
I.e. 20% between 9 p.m. and 9 a.m.
Yep, absolutely. Yep. At least, and this is from South County EMS. I'm pulling that data from our calls. That has to do with our demographics in town, that if we were a college town, more of our calls might be at, you know, 1 a.m., 2 a.m. In sleepy Deerfield, Sutherland, and Whately, the majority of our calls are when people are out, when they're at work, when they're at play, when they're driving around. So that's why we see that shift there. And that's based on our own information. Stunned silence.
I'd also like to add, that was one part of the question that was asked. It was also a statement, and I think the essence of the statement was missed. The essence was that South County is continually looking at what's happening and trying to match our services to what the services that are needed. Specifically, we were having trouble. Our specific problem was, as it was discussed, was staffing A2. We had a hard time staffing A2. What we did find was, by looking at the numbers, finding when the services were needed, we were able to add a third paramedic per diem.
Impact shift. Yeah, not even just Zach paramedic. I mean, whatever, an extra person.
Yeah, yep. Zach called it impact shift. And by having that impact shift, we were able now not to miss calls. We were more readily available to answer that call. And as explained, when it was first put out there, although we had a very good study, and if you looked at the number that he had, the calls and everything, the study was real good, but we're finding things that are not exactly exact to that study, and that the three towns has their own ebbs and flows, and the ambulance service is continually trying to match, and we haven't got there yet, because we said it was a three-year program, and we're not there at the third year yet. We're trying to match those needs to what we're trying to provide.
Oh, I was just going to say, I thought your presentation was excellent. Thank you very much.
Yes, Zach, what do you mean by missed calls? You never fail to show up if the ambulance is called.
You will always get an ambulance if you dial 911. It might not always be South County EMS.
Okay.
There are times where we get simultaneous calls, and that's when we might miss a call, only meaning that another service has to come in mutually.
Thank you.
So I missed calls is kind of a flippant way for me to say it, but you will get an ambulance. Don't worry, it's just when we have more calls than we can handle with our current staffing. Yes.
How long does it take you to staff that A2 once A1 is gone?
So typically, the question was, how long does it take to staff A2 once A1 is gone? The plan was that these people would sign up for A2, and they would actually go to the station whenever A1 goes out, so they would be available. People just don't have the ability to sign up for those blocks, so the response times for E2 are longer. They're like 10 to 12 minutes because it represents the time that people have to, just like our previous systems, leave what they were doing, go and get the ambulance, and then respond out.
Where are these staffs coming from? Sunderland, Whately, Greenfield, Northampton?
It would be in our coverage area, so Deerfield, Sunderland, or Whately. Our most active EMTs live in Sunderland, and A2 is dispatched out of the Sunderland station. So typically they are on the road within a minute or so. We also have myself. I'm working Monday through Friday, actually 10 to 6 at mirrors the busiest times. And between the two of us, we're able to usually dispatch somebody to the scene directly and immediately. to arrive on scene and start rendering and initiating care while somebody gets the ambulance to then transport. So when possible, as a paramedic, I get on scene, I start care immediately within that golden 7 minutes, and then the ambulance arrives when we're ready to transport out. And we take
so you arrive with an ambulance or just yourself?
It's actually in my personal vehicle. I have a permit, and I have flashy lights in my own vehicle. We're just in a three-ambulance fleet. I don't have anything fancy, no supervisor or chief vehicle or anything like that. So I respond in my personal vehicle with gear. I assist I'm assisted by the police department. They have equipment as well from the three towns. The Deerfield, Whately, and Sunderland officers are always quick to respond to any medical calls that we do have. So they're sometimes on scene before us, rarely, but sometimes, and they have medical equipment as well.
So what is the percentage of staffing out of the district?
There is nobody responds out of the district.
No, I'm saying how many staffers do you have that are out of Sunderland, Whately, or Deerfield?
The majority.
The majority?
You're
asking the question. You want to know how many people are coming from the outside of...
For 911 calls? For emergency calls?
No, from the staff.
To staff aid to...
When they're called. When the call comes in, you're asking, when the call comes in, is that staff literally sitting in one of the three tents? Is that your question?
Where are they coming from?
I think so, yes.
They're not. He's not asking where they live. He's asking where they're sitting.
He's asking where the responders are coming from. Sunderland, Deerfield, Whately, or someplace else.
Or Greenfield or Northampton.
Right.
One of our qualifications, one of our requirements for somebody to be responding to the station when a call comes in is that they reside in our coverage area, Deerfield, Sunderland, or Whately. So sometimes we have staff members that come in for a shift and cover, and they might live outside, but that's when a 911 call comes in and somebody responds to the station, just like your local fire departments, they live within the district, they live within the area, and they go and they get the equipment.
So if you're the third person and you're gone by yourself, now you have to wait for a paramedic or an EMT to staff A2 to meet you at the destination, correct?
As I understand your question, yes. We need two people to transport on an ambulance. And so when A2 only has one EMT available, you're absolutely right. We need to have somebody else either arrive on scene or we request mutual aid from a neighboring town.
What is your estimated time, roughly, from the time they pick up the truck, or by the time they get the call, pick up the truck, and on site?
So if you're sitting in your office,
yep.
A1's out on the road,
yep.
A call comes in for A2,
yes.
You pick up and go to the scene,
yep.
Tones go out,
yep.
Somebody responds to Sunderland to pick up the ambulance and go to the call. Do you have an average response time for that second truck from time of tone to time on scene?
It's typically 10 to 12 minutes, so 11 minutes response time for A2. From time of dispatch to when the ambulance arrives at the patient's side.
Okay, in order to get that 10 to 12 minutes, where is that staffer coming from?
Within the area, typically within Sunderland. Our most active EMTs, two of the three live in Sunderland.
Because if somebody's coming from South Deerfield that has to go to Sunderland to get the ambulance.
I know, which is why we want to centralize.
And now they got to go back to, say, Deerfield.
Absolutely, yep.
It's going to take more than 10 or 12 minutes. I don't see where you're getting these averages.
I'm telling you, the average response time for A2 is 10 to 12 minutes, so 11 minutes. The average response time is 11 minutes, and that's primarily because our EMTs that are staffing A2 live in Sunderland, and that's where the ambulance is. So they're very close to the station, so there isn't an additional backtracking that has to occur.
Part of what we're trying to do by getting all the ambulances and the staff and the personnel into one place is when that second call comes in, Zach can immediately go get in that ambulance and go to the scene. And the second EMT, whether they're coming from Sunderland, Whately, or Deerfield, can meet him on scene. He can show up on scene and begin to provide care for that patient. So while it may take If the person's coming out of West Whately and they got to go to North Deerfield, and it takes them 18 minutes to get there, it may only take Zach 10 minutes to get there in the ambulance, and he can begin providing care at that 10-minute point.
We don't leave the scene for 17 to 20 minutes. When I say that we bring the emergency room to your side, I mean that. So all the same care that you would get in the emergency room, we're doing in your bathroom, or we're doing in your living room. So we're not ready to actually transport for nearly 20 minutes. So if one person can respond with the ambulance and initiate call within that 7 minutes, if it takes that additional person 15 minutes to arrive, they're still not delaying transport or care.
Okay, you ready?
Over here first, yes?
Yeah. Once you get at a location, central location, wherever it may be, with all three ambulance housed together, your operation in that facility, are you envisioning the, and after some initial startup costs, are you envisioning the operating budget to decrease for each of the towns after? If you thought about that at all, or?
So, we'll certainly be more efficient.
More efficient, right.
I don't know what that means monetarily. I don't have enough experience in that type of thing to be able to make a statement about that. There's certainly,
I can explain from the Board of Oversight.
Yes.
From the Board of Oversight, guys, keep me honest. We have looked at what are we paying today in rent at our three locations. That's kind of been our guiding principle to what are we going to pay in rent in the future. In that ballpark, it doesn't handcuff us, it doesn't lock us in. That's what we anticipate paying this year. What are we going to pay in the near future? When we sat down and talked with Whately, initial conversations were had, and the initial figures came back. I'm going to be honest, you can smack me afterwards. This is what they're paying today, so you can pay us about the same, and it should work. And we said, well, no. We want to look at actual cost. What's it going to cost us to have that space? What's it going to cost you square foot to operate this building? And what's a fair share to apportion to us? And after we had that discussion and we went back and hashed through figures, the numbers came back and it looked like around $30,000 between rent, heat, light. I think we've got power on our own and some of the heat on our own, but some of the shared expenses were about $30,000. For us to rent the space that we're looking to rent. And then we looked at the building costs. What's it going to cost us to build out the space?
It was 20,000. We offered
20,000
plus utilities.
Plus utilities. Right. It was about 30,000 and we're done.
Right. The utilities are unknown.
Yes.
Correct.
And Whately, speaking with Whately, they were gracious enough to extend an offer that said, your building cost, we're willing to bond for that with our building. We'll bond it as long as you sign the lease for. So if you do a 10-year lease with us, you can bond those expenses over 10 years. You do a 5-year lease, you can bond it over 5. You do a 3-year lease, you can bond it over 3. So as a Board of Oversight, it becomes more attractive to us to be able to do that. Do we know today, as we sit here, what that final cost is going to be? We've received some estimates from architects. If it's to be professionally built out by contractors and construction crew. But again, in speaking with the Board of Oversight, our hope is to be able to use or provide opportunity to Franklin County Tech School to perform some of the work for us, to work with the Sheriff's Department to perform some of the work for us, to give folks an opportunity to learn while they build a space that we're looking to move into. We are fortunate enough that, and please, you can quote me on this, nobody is throwing us out of where we currently operate. And we've had discussions with all three landlords, so to speak. They understand where we're at, they understand where we're going, and they're willing to work with us. That said, none of our current locations, as Zach has explained, suit our needs. So we're at a point we need to do something moving forward. So part of the hope behind this time is to provide some education. Again, after the meeting's over, we'd be happy to walk you through the space and show you what we're looking at. We've looked at a number of different places.
Let me pick it up here.
Go ahead.
He missed the last meeting.
We've actually, Board of Oversight has actually gone out and prepared an RFP for space. It means that anybody in our target region can tell us what they can give us, and we can compare it against anybody else. What Matt has talked about is a really good option for us. If we get one a lot better or better that's on the table, we're going to be reviewing it as part of the RFP. The RFP should go out within the next couple of days, and it should level the playing field for what is the best deal for South County EMS to reside in one place to give us the services that I think the towns deserve. So that's just an update, and the RFP will be is being proposed by the three, or being created by the three town administrators, and will go out. And that's, again, to prove or to allow for fairness across the playing field.
Yes.
My question was, you mentioned the staff A2, you pay the people on call $8 an hour. Is that 24/7 for two people, or is that 24/7 for four people?
Two people. So we need two people to run an ambulance, so they're offered $8 an hour to sign up for 8-hour blocks, and then they make their full rate when they're activated.
Okay, and to staff the third ambulance, what do you pay for those?
Only when somebody responds on the third ambulance will they make their normal.
But they don't. They don't get any standby pay.
No. We don't. We don't have any sign up or standby for the third ambulance. We consider that a reserve ambulance for these extra things.
My next question deals with the fact: have anybody on the Board of Oversight looked at the Coates Avenue building that the town of Deerfield owns that has 3,500 square feet, has water and sewer available, and it's centrally located on about 16 or 17,000 square feet, if I'm not correct, I could stand corrected, and it's got 3,500 feet, clear span, and room enough probably to put a loft in, to be able to take care of all your needs, located centrally in South Deerfield. Has anybody actually looked at it, or just turned a blind eye, and we made our mind up, we're going away?
Can I just say one thing? It's okay, Bob, to have a discussion, okay? Please keep it civil.
I am.
No, Bob. Keep it civil and let's have a discussion. Because through an honest discussion back and forth, we will come to a solution. We're not here to argue with one of us. You see that right now? You had three people that lives were saved.
I believe you. And all right, I'm fine. I don't have any problem with the service.
Then stay civil.
No, I don't have
stay
any problem
civil.
With the service. What I'm trying to say is, have you turned a blind eye
no.
to the alternates?
No.
And just decided you're going to
no.
the next part of the building?
No.
That's why there's an RFP.
No. It hasn't been offered to us.
Okay. Yeah, it's an RFP is out on it, Bob.
The RFP is not out yet.
Yes, it is. The town of Deerfield is trying to sell it.
Exactly.
I looked at it today.
When does the RFP go out, and when is the decision to be made? Because we're holding a considerable amount of space and have been for several months because we were led to believe that SCEMS was very interested in Whately, and
Zach is not the person to answer.
Okay, you got
so
it.
To the book. The RFP is on the table being created now. It should be out next week. In a very short period of time, it should be
it's,
window of time.
Cool. All right. And sure. we looked at and we considered many different places. The purpose of the RFP is just to show and make it clear for everybody the decision of, you know, where it things are going is above board. That
and so there'll be costs to reflect whatever choice.
So do we know when the proposals will be due
to the Board of Oversight?
Yeah.
Do we have a ballpark?
Hey, Doug, we got any information on that? Not to put you on the spot.
Not at all. We're working to finalize a draft RFP by the end of this week. It'll have to get approval not only by town administrators, but also legal counsel. Once the RFP is complete, I hope to get it published in the Central Register by next Tuesday. We have to, according to 30B, publish it twice in a local newspaper, no less than 14 days before the closing date. The earliest I can get it in the newspaper is going to be next Wednesday. The earliest we can close will be 2 weeks plus 1 day after that, which would wind up being the 21st of April. Then the proposals as in response will have to be assessed.
So I thank you, Doug. And I guess my point would be to Bob and to anyone else who has the same thought, that that's a clear timeline as to when any other facility can respond and make its best bid for the housing of the South County EMS. And then the people who read the proposals will assess, and I'm guessing there'll be a weighted scale on proposals that are received. They'll get a sense of what bids are in the best interest of the residents of all three towns. So I don't call that a blind eye to any facility. I call that opening it up to any facility that thinks that its location has merit to fulfill the public safety demands and needs of every resident in each of the three towns.
Is the RFP specifically looking for a building, or is land an option for a possible build, or what's the wording?
The wording is to supply us with housing, and how they get there. And if, you know, if somebody wants to build something, can do it expeditiously, it will be weighted on that aspect if they come on land. But we don't have a lot of time. We're thinking for the best interest of the townspeople, the residents of South County, to move this as quickly as we can to fruition.
In the back.
Yeah, could you explain a little more what the procedure will be once you've received the RFPs, the decision-making process, and whatever else has to transpire? I understand that not everything's cut in stone.
According to 30B, an RFP like this has to be what's called a sealed bid. There's going to be two parts of the proposal. The first part will consist of the response to our criteria, whether a building has the space, whether it has the electricity, whether it has the heat, whether it has the garage bays enough to fit three ambulances plus, whether it has the facilities necessary or stipulated in the RFP. Those things will be weighted, along with geographic location, ease of access, and a number of other factors that the EMS deems important to maintaining a high quality of service. Once those weights are considered, the RFPs will be given a grade, essentially. Then, upon determining the highest grade RFP, then the price proposal will be opened. All of these criteria will be assessed independent of the cost of the rent. That being said, any RFP that gets issued, it's probably going to wind up being Deerfield, that is the decision-making authority. The proposal may be rejected. All proposals may be rejected. We could choose to go out again. My guess is that the decision-making authority will rest first with the Board of Oversight, and then with the town of Deerfield. I could be wrong on that. But I'm going to rely on the Board of Oversight, and I assume to make the final decision.
The committee will make a recommendation to the Board of Selectmen in Deerfield, whoever the committee is, and the Board of Selectmen are basically trust that aspect of the decision-making process. Who will actually make up that board? The Board of Oversight will do it to try to make it fair and equitable to all people, having some sort of representation as best we can.
I appreciate, you know, what the information. It still isn't, I guess, who gets the ultimate decision making on the location of the facility?
The final or the recommended?
The final.
Final is done through defined in the IMA, our intermunicipal agreement, and I think you've read that many times, Skip.
I have, but I just wasn't sure that
I think it's all defined in the IMA.
The IMA stipulates that any change in location must be ratified by the town meetings in each of the member towns.
So ultimately, this ends up going to
town meeting.
Town meeting.
Absolutely.
None of us will have a town meeting scheduled.
Correct.
The annual town meeting will have long since passed.
Correct.
Okay.
That really was what my question was.
I thought so. But that's why it said final or the record. So the Board of Oversight will make a recommendation to our fiscal agent, which is the town of Deerfield. Then the town of Deerfield, the town of Deerfield makes an exception, agrees with that, then we'd have to craft a warrant article for the three towns. But one of the things that you asked earlier about that other location, Bob, the one thing I do question is that I don't believe, and Zach, you may know more, I don't think South County EMS in itself can go out and get a loan.
The town of Deerfield would have to cover it.
So the town of Deerfield.
So that you have over $500,000 as of July 1 in your surplus account of some sort. And I don't think it would cost you that much to do your renovation, Tom. Okay? But what I want to make clear is the RFP comes back, that gets scored in executive session. No public input is going to be into that at all. And then after they score it in the non-public session, then they're going to open up and find out what it's going to cost. And it doesn't
have to be.
Well, I just want to make sure that it opens.
Why do you say that? Why?
Because that's the way the RFPs are done.
No. RFPs are written in any number of ways.
No, the RFPs are brought in and then we open them in public session.
But what do you?
And the RFPs are read in open. And the RFPs are read in open session.
How are they going to be scored?
It'll be listed in the RFP.
If you want, we have to go through it and weight the scoring, such as how is finances arranged, location. My suggestion is that we put a pin in the map, and I'm just talking about what the town of Beverly. This is not a new concept.
I listened to you last week.
The town of Beverly put a pin in the map and say we need a place within a X amount of radius. I think we would do the same thing. It's not a hard concept.
Where is the pin?
Wherever our center mass is.
If I asked where that report was to find out where the pen was, I haven't been able to find out.
Bruce Baxter, when he issued his report, looked at response times from both South Deerfield Fire and Sunderland Fire. His recommendation was that housing be somewhere between the two locations.
So there was no pen?
There was a range. So basically, Sunderland Fire Station, up to the light in the center of Sunderland, north on 116, make a right, go to the South Deerfield Fire Station. Somewhere along that corridor was his recommendation for a place where it should be.
That report is available on the FERCOG website. It's a Google search. I Googled it the other day and I picked it up. So it's, if anybody's interested, FERCOG, regional EMS, and it'll pop up.
The response time maps were included in our original presentation that we did 2.5 years ago. We kicked this off.
Well, we all can't remember that.
Oh, but wait a moment. You want to hook me up? I'll pull it up for you.
I don't need it right now.
Oh, you don't?
I believe you.
Okay.
I just want to verify it later.
That's fine.
Joe?
I would say that probably South Deerfield Fire is probably on, if you look at the response time that Zach put up there today, South Deerfield Fire is probably as far east and north that we want to go. If you looked at the response times, and if you start looking at Sunderland and Whately, there's a difference, there's quite a difference in the response time, or there is a difference in response time. So I would say it has to be someplace between the Sunderland Bridge and South Deerfield Fire, I think.
Who's going to designate where that penny is going to get dropped?
If you want, you can. I don't care. We don't care. As long as you do it with a reason and you show it's our center mass.
Do you have a study of where that penny
is? Yes, we have.
Yes, we do.
Yes, we do.
And another question I have with...
We have a couple other questions that, you know, that rated at time. So, Jeff, you raised your hand basically for the last six minutes.
Go ahead. Very quickly.
We'll come back to you.
Right. Very quickly. I was just wondering how specific that RFP is. As far as I know, there's concerns about actually having access to training, a training area. And how many square feet is that? And I'm just, I guess my concern is if this is included in the RFP, and, you know, South Deerfield Fire District has offered that training area. So I just hate to see duplication as far as expense in a building. And I don't know if that would work for South County or not, but, and I'm sure maybe, you know, Whately or Sunland may offer area for a training facility, but I'm not sure. I'm asking.
We have had offers from all three towns for training facilities, both the towns themselves and the fire district, because basically there's four different entities involved in that aspect of it. So we have that, and we have other locations that would probably be very willing to allow EMS-type training to exist. So we can go to colleges, we can go... We don't have to duplicate the space, but
right.
it is available.
That was my concern.
We'll take less
square footage.
We'll take credit for extra training or extra things, but they're not the center mass of what we need.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Now you were talking about construction here in Whately. What are you actually talking about?
Well. After we looked at everything that was available to the Board of Oversight, and this building came available, the town of Deerfield looked at buying the building for EMS and for the senior center. The town of Whately graciously stood up and said that they'd take it and consider that for applications in their town and whatever else could fit in here. It's been known from the beginning that basically this would be a consideration for the ambulance service going. Matter of fact, with all of our research, which accused of blind eyes or not, we have looked at the center of Deerfield, center of Sunderland, we've looked at Whately in many different areas and different things that have come available to us. This building was the best with the proposal that Whately had given to the South County EMS, and that the construction in this building would have been walls and access to and security to the needs of the EMS facility in the far corner of this building using the bay for the ambulance services.
So we're talking about all the facilities that Zach mentioned, that like a kitchen, sleeping quarters, and all of that,
though? Available here, yes.
Do you have a rough estimate on what we're talking about, construction?
We have rough estimates, but they're a pretty large
range
that we're looking at, from a Cadillac to what we really need to make the jumping off point start. So,
so
the Board of Oversight had never been able to get to the point of locking down the information, as Matt had said, that it was a floating scale as to whether we did it 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, and what the payback would be. And in all of the cases, it came back less than what we're paying for rent now, when we crunched the numbers out of it.
That including dividing your electric, your AC?
It would be our own electric, our own AC, it would be our own gas. There would be split off on everything, our telephone communications, everything else. Were split off. The only thing that would be common to this building was the offer for this space for meeting and training, some of the bigger spaces for bigger events. But that's not part.
Do you have a air purifying system on that side of the building? So once those diesel trucks start and everything,
fully built out.
It's
fully built out.
Because it was for the bookmobile, so it basically had to already be here. It basically, they ran those vehicles while they were loading the books. And
the bays are done. It's only the living space that would require.
It had to be built out. There's very little to the bays. There is some modification for storage and some other things that the bays would take, but we definitely would try to get local, either volunteer or the colleges or those tech schools to handle it.
kick me anytime I get out of line, guys.
Oh, you're doing well. Dylan?
I thank you very much for the presentation. I have two questions. One on, I really appreciate the RFP process. I think that'll give everybody a sense of what the options are and how you guys are going about deciding it. With regards to this facility, I know it's just one of the options. Has it been contemplated with the current access out to the main road, or is there other means of access out to 116 being contemplated? And then the other question, which is not related, is...
Can I take that one before you?
Sure, yeah, go ahead.
The ambulance service saw a great value in being able to go quickly to 116. We went to the owners of that property and it for their economic and their responsibility for that property, it was refused for us to use that as an emergency entrance or access egress from this building. The Board of Oversight with the police and fire, or police and ambulance, the local, didn't cherish that thought process because quicker is better for everybody, but we respect it and we evaluated the way of having to go out Pine Street at this point in time and felt that if that needed to be, we could, it wasn't a deal breaker in that aspect of it.
Okay.
Second question?
Thank you. On the ambulance replacement, could you guys talk about the thought process of moving it up a year? I understand the age of the fleet, but we also knew that when the ambulance started. So kind of what changed that led to push that up a year?
Yeah, my understanding, and Zach can whack me on the side of the head whenever it feels like it, is the fact that the third ambulance is costing a lot in maintenance in its stands right now. And the other two ambulances, the other ambulance is older than what we would like to have as an A2 ambulance. It's just going to be going down the same trail as our A3 is at this point in time. We have, as been pointed out, we have about $440,000 or $500,000 in unencumbered funds or whatever title you want to put on that. And that includes the money that we've been putting aside, which is about $153,000 for the replacement of the ambulance, which is included in that $400,000. It's not an additional number.
But only 50 of that's in there because the other 50 is FY16 and the other 50 is an FY17.
Okay. Is right. There 150? Yeah. Okay. Well, it's included in the numbers when we get to the end of 17. It's not included in there in 16 and it's not included in 15. But the total number left over when we get into 17 is an estimated $500,000. And we can look at the numbers in that.
There's $500,000 of retained earnings. $89,000 of that was previous capital, which was supposed to be rolled over. There's $50,000 that's going towards FY16 indirect costs, which leaves us $350,000 of retained earnings that aren't accounted for. Of that $350,000 in FY17 budget,
60.
So, thank you. In FY, yes, of that $350,000.
Of the 350, 60 is in the FY17 budget.
Yes, to offset the cost. And the other portion, including that capital, is going to fund the ambulance replacement. Here's why we bumped that. I don't like to see it as bumped that ambulance replacement up, because that ambulance needs to be replaced. Let's forget about A3. Let's just take it out of picture. We need two ambulances to operate and transport and take care of those 800 people a year. We need two ambulances to do it. As I said, the estimated lifespan of an ambulance is 10 years. So our goal in the service is to always have those two ambulances to be within that 10-year mark. And that means our frontline truck, which is doing 750 calls a year, will be 1 to 5 years old, and it'll have the most recent equipment, the most recent safety measures, all those things. Our second line truck, which is responsible for the remainder of the calls, that 6%, will be 5 to 10 years old. And then, if we have a third truck that is still usable after 10 years, it will enter into this reserve duty as a backup for our community outreach to our elementary schools, things, our football standbys, things like that. So our frontline truck is a 2010. Great, it's within 10 years. Our second line truck is a 2007. which means that it's tipping over in about 10 years. So it would still be up for replacement this upcoming year anyway. The replacement schedule we had, which was to allocate $51,000 a year towards the replacement of an ambulance, would have made us use these ambulances longer than they're routinely considered viable for. The fact that we have these retained earnings from our first year of service means that we have the luxury of replacing this ambulance now that when we need to. So by replacing one in FY17, our frontline truck will be brand new, so it'll be between 1 and 5 years old. Our second line truck will be, well, it'll be 7 years old, but it'll be between 5 and 10. And then a third line truck will be 10 years old. And if it still makes sense financially for us to keep it, and we can keep it in the rotation, wonderful. If something were to happen to it, then that's a discussion for another day. But our goal is to have, we need two ambulances to run our service, and to have them both within that 10-year mark. So either, any way you slice it, we're up for a replacement, and we have the luxury of doing it.
That was a great off, John, but did it answer your question?
It did. You know, it's just, that's, it's challenging on the budget side. You know, these are reserves that were planned, these capital plans that were put in place years ago, and so when we're changing the timelines, it just makes it tougher. I understand the money's there, but, you know, that's, I think, everybody's concerns with capital projects. If money's sitting around, we'll use them for something. And so that's why I just wanted to see what the difference was when the capital plan was first put together and now.
Yeah, and the capital plan couldn't go any faster because we started only 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to get money unless we ask for $100,000. And as I readily admit to everybody, when we started this thing, we asked for a three-year program because we don't know. At the end of that three-year program, I welcome everybody to come in, scurry through all the documentation, prove where we can be better or do something different and stuff of that nature. We are trying to anticipate the needs. We take a shot on a study that was done by an individual who we find is pretty close to accurate, but he's not 100%. He doesn't know Deerfield, Sunderland, Whately. He knew just ambulance services. He knew that the services provided by volunteers were on their way out because companies don't support it anymore, they don't let their people go anymore, they don't have the resources that allows people to be available when most of our calls happen. He told us that. We believed differently and we built it around a call force in which we were now readapting to having something different, a modified system which will have call force, will have, but we'll have a paramedic there on a very needed period of time. And I think the Board of Oversight, and I can't commend them enough, these three towns have put three great groups of people together. And I think they're doing an outstanding job of looking at how to make this a better activity. And are they geniuses? Are they doing it all with full $100 of skills? No, we're learning as we go. And
You had asked earlier about the study. It's on the FERCOG, FRCOG.org. And if I could, this is on page 14 of that report, if you were asked if it was done professionally. And it says, based on the data, a fully staffed ambulance covering the three communities located in either the South Deerfield Fire District location would minimally result in a 30% consistent improvement in ambulance response times based upon similar projects in suburban rural areas, based upon all call locations and immediate ambulance availability. As an alternative, the Sunderland Fire Department location would provide a consistent 27% improvement in response time based on the same parameters. And it said, and if you go on to the thing, they have Appendix 1 and 2 will actually show the data. But this was determined by analyzing the matrix data as well as evaluating call location using call location gen code overlay on GIS mapping. What does that mean? It sounds like if you could go from Deerfield or Sunderland, it'd be about the same.
3% difference.
I don't, just because I live here, I know what does that mean. If I lived in, by Carolyn's house, that's East Deerfield, West Deerfield. It's going to take a lot longer to get there from Sunderland, but there's fewer calls there, so in statistics, it's going to tell you it's not that big a deal. Just like I know if you're in South Deerfield, it's going to take longer to get to my house in North Sundall. So there is the study. It is on the FERCOG webpage, and it was professionally done.
Can I get a copy of that from my internal?
From Deerfield?
Yeah.
I'm sure that
Doug.
Yeah, Doug would be able to get that for you.
We'll print it out first thing. Thank you.
How's that? Okay.
Bob.
Just one point. I want to emphasize. I think you're running a fine service. Okay, and I have no problem with the way you respond to the calls and the professionalism and what have you. My concern deals with where the ambulance is based, and no disrespect for any of the people that are involved in the service and the hard work they do.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Go ahead.
No matter where this facility is located, what would be the cost and who will be assuming costs for getting across a state highway? For example, access to 116, would there be new lights put in? Are they timed to stop all the traffic? And who assumes costs like that?
As with the fire district, when it was put in there without any lights and none on 5 and 10, the state would evaluate, because it is a state road, whether or not it was a hazard to an ambulance accessing that area. One thing I want to make sure you understand is with an ambulance service, no matter which way they go, they have to evaluate the route.
Yeah.
There may be many reasons that they won't go in one direction or another, being school being let out, special events. They keep track of all of that stuff so that basically, no matter where you go, like, you know, they may go down through the center of South Deerfield if Yankee Candle's having a major event and the roads are all blocked up, you know, like the car show.
Car show.
Like that, yeah. They may go around and go down and come back out the other way, get up and go to Whately that way, because time efficiency is where they're living from. They drive these roads. You see the vehicles out there every day, learning what the roads are, learning where the potholes are, learning what, you know, hazards may be happening, whether they're opening the road to do something differently. It doesn't mean that a particular road will be the everyday road. It will be, they will evaluate it on a case-by-case basis.
So those costs have already been figured in if they had to get new lighting systems to...
That would be done by the state. Timing, like you said, we don't have a right, and we can't force them to put something out on 116 to let us out. If it becomes a problem, then, you know, one of the things might be that we dispatch a police officer to let them get out, because we know that that's an issue that we're going to have to deal with.
The state has been good enough to put sensors on the lights that are out on the main roads, and then we have a device on top of all the emergency vehicles that'll set it off, that'll lock the light.
So they can time the traffic.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So again, we'd have to work with the state. They'll do their study, they'll evaluate it, and then they would let us know.
Well, my question popped into mind when Dylan talked about getting access over somebody's absolutely to get out of here if this were the site.
It's one
more
of the,
direct
right.
route.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's many subjects that have blessed us on our table when we have to sit and mull through all this. And Zach brings a lot of good data to us to make sure that we're not making decisions in the blind. And
I'm curious about something else, and this may be redundant but or not applicable anymore, but I used to see, living in Old Deerfield, used to see the ambulance parked at the Old Deerfield Fire Station. Does that still happen, or is that passé now?
Was
that temporary?
That was just as a community outreach, as a get out of, you know, got cabin fever in that 12 by 17 foot room, need some fresh air type thing.
Okay.
So it's still, you very well could see ambulances around or parked or visiting with people, but it wasn't a specific, like, remotely staged or anything, no.
Okay.
We do encourage the EMTs to get out and spend time with the local police departments and the local fire departments. We want folks to be able to work together. We want them to be comfortable with one another. So if you see the ambulance parked at one of the three police stations or police cruisers over at the South Deerfield station, it doesn't mean the boys are inside playing poker. You know, sometimes it's the police have used their jump bag on a scene and they need resupply. They've gone through an inspection, things are out of code, they need to get resupplied. Or just, hey, we got a new officer, we've got a new EMT, we wanted to introduce you. So when you meet each other on the scene, it's not who the heck are you? And are you really an EMT because I've never seen you before? We also, I mean, part of, when I ran Deerfield EMS, there was no, relationships between South Deerfield Fire, Old Deerfield Fire, Deerfield EMS have gone through different stages. And we were trying to encourage additional relationship building and working with the chief in that town. Chet was very good in, especially when we were having trouble responding, getting his folks more involved in responding to calls, especially if the ambulance only went with one person, or going to start medical care or give us some type of a patient update before we got there.
You know, I know it's been difficult. A lot of the Dylan age kids, my kids, have moved away from Old Deerfield.
Right. I can say the relationships, I think relationships are in a good place today. I think we've accepted feedback from other agencies, and we've charged Zach with, make sure you get out there and you're talking with these folks, let them know what you're doing. His monthly reports that he provides to us are distributed to all three towns. We ask that they're posted on the website, so monthly you should be able to go in and look and see exactly what we're doing. Our meetings are open. We've got nothing to hide. We encourage comments and feedback.
Well, I'm president of the Deerfield Lions Club, and our organization has contributed heavily in the past to the ambulance. We did a huge fundraiser, what was it, about 15 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
Is it probably 01?
You bought the first one, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so we're always interested in how we can help in the future. So that's why I wanted to hear more about things.
We'll be sending you a wish list
for the staff.
We certainly appreciate
you.
It.
Yeah, we do.
Bring my checkbook. I mean the club checkbook.
You know, the checkbook is one thing. The other piece we'll get into at some point when we decide on a location is if we do need to do remodeling work inside. I don't know what that looks like, and I don't know all the legalities of what we can do, but I know Mark has talked about services in Vermont where they've asked for volunteers in the community to come in and spend some time, be it pounding nails, doing some painting, sheetrocking, helping to pull wires. I don't know, but we get to that point, we'll be sure to reach out, and if there's anything you can do, we'll certainly appreciate it.
The club members have already expressed an interest in supporting continuing education for the EMTs and paramedics, so we'll probably go in that direction.
Excellent.
Because as we age, our knees don't hold out as well, our backs don't hold out as well. And of course, we're always looking for new members. That's a plug.
Sure. Thank you for the support.
I'm a stickler for data and good, solid data. There's a question about AT response, and I threw out that, like, kind of like 10 to 12 minutes. Here's our response time graph for just Ambulance 2. So this is the one staffed by our local EMTs. The average response time is 9.5 minutes. That's this blue line there. And fractal response time, if you're into that type of thing, is 16 minutes. So this is percent of calls, and that's response time. So there's the data there. Average response time is 9.5 minutes. Fractal is 16.2.
One thing understood, and correct me, because I want to make sure this is stuff. The 7 minutes plus average and the fractal that goes along with it is all calls from the service, including A2. So even though it takes a little longer, that's in the average, that's in the mix for how long it takes these people to respond to you when you need them. And I think that's pretty impressive. Because that's a lot of area that they cover.
And unless there are any other questions, I want to.
Well, I have a hard time trying to figure out Deerfield, both from the South Deerfield Fire Station northward and right around the South Deerfield Fire Station, is the most populated area. and I have a hard time understanding on why you would move an ambulance further away from that population area. I mean, it's hard for me to...
There's two things at play there. One is, one ambulance is at the South Deerfield Fire Station. The other two are much farther away. And we're trying to consolidate closer to where our major call volume is. So we need to find a location where we can consolidate. So that's part of what's playing into this. The other thing, too, is from an operational standpoint, and having driven an ambulance tens of thousands of hundreds of thousands of times in my life, from the South Deerfield Fire Station, we can access 116 North to Conway very well. We can access Old Deerfield very well. Accessing and 91 very well. Accessing South Deerfield is quite difficult for us. Despite our proximity to South Deerfield, any way we go, we're either contesting with 91 traffic, we're contesting with Yankee Candle traffic, commuter traffic. We have to deal with the elementary school. We can't get straight over into the center of South Deerfield without either going to the elementary school or a four-way stop. I mean, we know how long it takes to get through that four-way stop. So when we're considering locations, proximity alone, while it might absolutely seem like that's the golden rule, from an operational standpoint, there's a lot more that we have to consider than just as the crow flies distance. So
Amtrak too.
Yeah, well, absolutely, right? Twice a day, high-speed trains. So there's a lot of things where, and not to pick on a location, the elephant in the room is this location here. From this location, from actually south of South Deerfield along 116, we can thread our way up into South Deerfield with be able to avoid all those problems that I just mentioned. So we can go up South Main, we can go up Sugarloaf, we can go up River, and then we can go up 116 if the call is over by Yankee Candle or something like that, but we only have to deal with that traffic. And also, that four-way stop, coming from the South Deerfield, or South Main Street end, there's always less traffic. So we can actually, with our emergency vehicle, come closer to that stop, not force other people out into the intersection, and navigate that four-way much safer than if we have to come up the Elm Street side. That's part of the reason why we were considering that end of town to be the most appropriate for us.
What's the actual distance from the South Deerfield Fire Station to here?
I don't know, but it doesn't... Well,
1.3 miles.
Okay, but here's really important.
1.something.
That only matters. That distance and that time only matters for calls at the South Deerfield Fire Station or north of that. Otherwise, we'd physically be just as far, if not closer, to calls in South Deerfield from the other end of South Deerfield, especially in our times would be shorter considering those other things. So yes, while it is a further 1.something miles to Old Deerfield.
No, it's 6 miles to Old Deerfield.
Well, but further, right?
Yeah.
That absolutely would result in, you know, longer travel time. But statistically, the majority of the people that we serve is South Deerfield. And when we serve so many people, we have to kind of take that into consideration. Mm-hmm.
Just a point of information, the four-way stop in the center of South Deerfield was not always a four-way stop. Sugarloaf Street and Elm Street used to be open 20
years
ago.
I know. That's great. Right now it's a four-way stop and we got to deal with it every time we go to
Sugarloaf Street.
Used to be a big building on the corner where Cumberland's is.
We're pushing 2 hours now. If there are no other questions, and I don't see any. I just want to thank the South County EMS, and I hope that everyone in the room can collectively agree that our priority needs to be public safety and getting response times as quickly as possible, and that I don't care whether you live in Sunderland, Whately, or Deerfield, we should all agree that the experts who have put together this service are the best people to figure out where the optimal place is to maximize public safety and put aside the parochialism that any of the three towns may or may not have and let them put the facility that's going to help the residents of all three of our towns best. So.
Very well said.
And there are a lot of our EMTs that have come tonight, so make sure, if you're interested, I'm going to put them all on the spot. If you want to meet and greet, shake some hands. I know they're all itching to say hello. And we got some. We have some gear out in the back as well, so we can. And if you want to see the ambulances,
see the
ambulance,
yeah. Just follow whoever. Thank you.
Good job, Zach.
Hey, Zach. Are we restricted from going over the bridge and therefore moving down right now?
So the short answer is yes.